Lane, again, I want to wish everybody a happy new year. Those I haven't met with last week, we're trusting God for great and mighty things. We are on a theme this year for 2017. I was just thinking about our name as a church, the Logos Church, which means the Word of God. The Bible says in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, the Word was with God, was God, and the Word became flesh. The Word is Jesus. When you speak of the Word of God, you're speaking of Jesus. Verse 14 says, and the Word became flesh. We want to focus in on the Word this year and be a church of the Logos. We studied the seven churches, and we mentioned earlier that each church reflected the spiritual condition of that church. The name of the church represented how the church functioned. It was a prophetic name, if you will. The church of Sardis had a reputation of being alive, but they were dead. That's exactly what happened in that church. The church of Philadelphia was a church that loved each other. It means brotherly love in the Greek. The church of Thyatira and Pergamos meant compromise, their names, and the worship of false gods. And that's what happened in the churches. They started to amalgamate themselves with false gods. And so the name of the church reflected the character and personality of the church. And I was thinking about that as I was studying, and as we were studying the seven churches. I said, what is our name as a church? Our name is Logos, the Word of God. Is it possible that this name is a spiritual reflection and a prophetic reflection of who we are? Well, it should be. And so because of that, we are going to be studying God's Word this year. We're going to be focused in on the Logos word. Last week, I preached on the importance of amalgamating and having a marriage between the Word and the Spirit. We learned last week that you can't understand God's Word unless the Spirit opens your eyes. And there's an amalgamation and a marriage between God's Word and God's power. And this year, we're going to be, again, focusing on understanding God's Word. And this morning, I have a very special word, I believe, for us. And we're going to be studying the attributes of God, the characteristics of God. As we get to know God's Word, we're getting to know Him. As we get to know Jesus, we get to know His Word. Remember, Jesus and the Word are one. As we study God's Word and get to know who God is, we draw closer to His Word, because His Word is who He is. The Bible calls God an omnipresent God. We're going to be studying His omniscience, His omnipotence, His power, His immutability, which means that He doesn't change. We're going to be studying His eternity, that God's eternal. We'll be looking at Him as Jehovah Nissi, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Tzidkenu, Jehovah Rohi, my shepherd, my righteousness, my sanctifier. We'll be studying in the Word. We'll be looking at who God is. And as we are studying who God is through His Word, I trust and believe that we're going to get to know Him and get to know His Word even better. Amen? So get ready for a nice pilgrimage together, a spiritual safari as we study His Word, so we can draw close to the God of His Word, the God of the Bible, knowing the God we worship, knowing the God of the Word. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Psalm chapter 1. Psalm chapter 1, we'll do the entire chapter today as we are focusing in on God's Word. George, can you have these lights on for me, please? Is that possible right over here? I appreciate that. Psalm chapter 1, the first 6 verses. The Bible says, blessed, very important. God says, this is the person I'm going to bless. We have a different viewpoint on being blessed, but here's what God says is the person whom He blesses. So we better listen, because this is whom God says is blessed. Are you ready? Blessed is the man that what? Walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. Okay. All right. Nor stands in the way of sinners. Oh boy. Nor sits in the seat of the scornful. Whoa. Okay. But his delight is in the law, the word of the Lord. And in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree that's planted by the rivers of water, that brings forth fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Father, we thank you for your precious word. Open our eyes and our understanding as we attempt, O Lord, to study. This year, we commit to you, 2017, that you would draw us closer to your word, that your word becomes alive. And I pray as we begin that this text will be a springboard of life, that you will help us understand, Lord, what you want us to know, so we can know the God of the word, the God of the Bible, so we can know you better, Lord. We thank you, and we give you all the praise and all the glory. And everyone said, amen. I've entitled this message simply, God's Blueprint for Blessing. God's Blueprint for Blessing. Does God have a blueprint? Does God have a prescription? Well, he does. In fact, in Joshua chapter 1, verse 8, the Bible is very clear. It says, if we obey the word of the Lord and we follow what the Bible says, Joshua chapter 1, 8, then the Bible says that God will bless you and whatever you do will prosper. Whatever you do, God's blessing will be upon you. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but thou shalt meditate. Meditate, and we're going to study what that word meditate means in a few moments. There, day and night, we keep seeing day and night. See, it's not enough, my friends, for us just to pick up the Bible every so often and kind of peruse it. And this is not what the Bible is teaching. We are to meditate. We are to seek the Lord day and night, and mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. Then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and thou shalt have good success. God's going to bless you. But there's some ingredients we need to look into. You know, we like the cake, but we don't like the recipe usually in life. We want the results right away. But God has a prescription on his blessing. God tells us how the blessing comes. We must understand that God's blessing is different the way the world thinks blessings are. God's blessings is not necessarily the physical realm, although that could be the case. But we as people, the normal, natural element of man is that we look at blessings from a natural perspective. And so if you got a big house and a big boat and a big car, you must be blessed. That might not be true at all. Blessings that come from God are not the blessings that the world might ascribe to. God looks at things a lot different than we do. What he says is blessed is different than what man says is blessed. Because man operates on the natural realm, God sees beyond that realm. And he says three don'ts about blessing, and he gives us one do about blessing. Three don'ts and one do. If you want to be blessed by God this morning, you're in the right place because God has a word for you. Three don'ts and one do by way of introduction. The first don't that we see here in our text comes in verse 1. The Bible says, don't walk in the counsel of the ungodly. Don't walk. Don't let it be your lifestyle. When the Bible speaks of walking, it's talking about a lifestyle. It's talking about things you do on a regular basis. Don't walk seeking the counsel of the ungodly. Don't follow their patterns. God says, I won't bless you if you adopt the lifestyle of the ungodly. If you become subject to what is in the natural realm with natural advice, with advice that is given by people who don't comprehend or understand the things of God, you become vulnerable to the world, vulnerable to a certain lifestyle if you take the advice of the ungodly. If you're walking in the counsel of the ungodly, the Bible says in the book of James, it's very clear that you become an enmity with God. If you are following the patterns of the world, taking the advice from the world, following the ways of the world, the Bible says That's like an enemy with God. You're on two different wavelengths. There's God's pattern, there's God's way, and there's the world's way. Remember what Jesus said? There's two paths. One path leads to eternal life, and the other path leads to destruction. But that path that leads to destruction, Jesus, is very wide. It's the ways of the world. It's what we read and see on television. It's how the world operates. The fashions of the world. The rudiments of the world. The Bible says you can't walk with God if you're walking in that pattern. You'll be vulnerable. You can't allow the trends of this world, the philosophies of this world, to contaminate you and corrupt you. You can't allow the course of this world to enter into your heart and begin to follow that pattern. Because Paul tells us also, he says, why are you setting your things on this world? He's giving advice to the Christians in Colossians chapter 3, verse 1. He says, don't set your affections in this world. Don't plant your roots deep in this world. That doesn't mean you don't have a vision or a goal. That doesn't mean you don't have a job that you want to focus on. And we're not talking about that. We all have to work and we all have to have a certain perspective and a vision while we're working. That's not what Paul is saying. What Paul is saying, don't set your roots. I mean, don't live like all you have is this world. Don't live by totally being absorbed with the philosophies of this world. Don't live by setting your roots so deep in the world that the eternal matters don't seem to matter much, because you are so set on following the patterns of this world. Paul says, set your affections on things above. Be more eternally minded. Now, this is what the Bible is telling us. But we all know that it's not as easy as it might sound, especially if we have people here this morning that have lived a life many years in the ways of the world. Those that have lived many years in following this world and being of the world. And now you've received Christ, and now you have this tension, and you have this sense of one way you're being pulled one way, and another way you're being pulled almost diametrically opposed. There's like a tension going on. You've got one foot over here, and you got another foot over here, and it's like you're being torn apart. You're being torn apart. One part of you is saying, go over here. Another part of you is saying, I want to go over here. And there's like an internal battle going on within you. I've experienced that very strongly in my life when I first became a Christian. And it doesn't go away right away. The enemy keeps playing games and keeps trying to tempt you and trying to dissuade you. We're in a battle, the Bible says. And so it's not as easy. It's not just a let's just do it. There's a process, and there's a discipline, and there's a focus that you and I need to do that the Bible speaks of. And I want to bring you to the next text. This is very important, George. It's found in Romans chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. And I want to show you how we can be a people who live in a different way. A people who please God. A people who can be blessed by God. Here we see a prescription that God gives us in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Watch this now. Romans chapter 12, please, George. I beseech you. The word beseech means it's almost like a begging. I implore you is the English translation. I implore you, brethren, by the mercies of God, watch this, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is in your reasonable service. Verse 2, now watch this, here's the key. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might be able to prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So stay right there, George, please. So Paul is saying, look, if you want to know God's will, if you want to be blessed by God, you can't be conformed to this world and to the philosophies of this world and the rudiments of this world and the way the world operates. You need to be transformed. Oh, okay. Well, how do I get transformed? The word transformed is a very interesting word. It means a transformation of mind and soul. The word transformed in the Greek is written in the passive tense. What the passive tense means is it's not active. And what do I mean by it's not active? It's passive. Well, the Greek tense is saying this. It's saying, watch this now. It's really nothing that you can do to transform yourself. There's no power in yourself that can transform you. What this means in the Greek, in the passive tense, what it's saying is you must allow the Spirit of God to work in you. You must allow, that's the passive tense. It's not you're forcing it, you're fighting with it. No. In other words, you are to surrender to the Spirit of the Lord. It's what Jesus said, not my will be done, but your will be done. You're surrendering. The word transformed is a Greek word that speaks of a metamorphosis. It's a transformation, a moth becoming a butterfly. As we allow the Spirit of God to touch our lives, as we allow the Spirit of God to minister to us by obeying His Word, that's what happens. By obeying His Word, what happens is we begin to experience a transformation of the mind. It's the mind. You see, it's all about, you see, before it goes down to your heart, it has to enter into your mind. It all begins in your mind. God is concerned about what is in your mind. And so don't allow this world to shape or conform you to this world. Don't allow the philosophies of this world to sway you, to cause you to live a certain way. You must not be conformed, Paul said, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind with what? With His Word. How much time do we actually spend studying God's Word? And we wonder why we're not transformed. Now, Pastor Dean, you just said it's nothing that I'm supposed to be doing. No, hold on now. I said that. I'm not saying you're not supposed to read. What I'm saying is you can't do anything to cause the transformation to take place in the power or energy of yourself. It's the work of the Holy Spirit. You understand me? You don't become holy because you decide, I'm not going to stop. I'm going to stop smoking. Stop smoking doesn't make you holy. I know a lot of people who don't smoke, but they got a very vile mouth, and the sin of gossip is just running rampant. So thank God you don't smoke, but take care of that mouth too. You understand what I'm saying? It's not about the exterior. It's not about the exterior. If you're moving in the alignment of this world, if you're moving with the way this world operates, the Bible says you won't be able to prove, watch this now, what is His will. Did you see that? Discern. The word prove in the Greek, actually the better translation is discernment. You won't have the discernment to know what is right or wrong. If you're operating in the fashions and the way of this world, you won't have the discernment to know what God is saying. You won't be able to discern what is right or wrong. And that's why the Bible says in Isaiah, in the last days which we're living today, people are going to call and proclaim what is good is evil. And they're going to be saying what is evil is good. There's no discernment today. Just look at what's happening. We don't even know the difference between good or bad. You can't prove what is God's will. You can't prove what is God's will because you have no discernment. You don't have any discernment because you're not transformed. You're not transformed because you're not seeking Him through His Word. We don't know His Word. Let's be honest. How much time do we spend in His Word? And some of us have been Christians for years. My goal is that we as a church and as a people will grow in knowing His Word, knowing the God of the Bible, knowing what He's saying, so we can be blessed, so God blesses us. You see, my friends, there are many people in the church that are being fed by the systems of this world. Social media, nothing wrong with social media in itself, I don't think. Television, there's some good things and some bad things. The internet, news, I understand that. I watch the news. I watch television on occasion. It's not about me watching a documentary or watch. That's not what we're talking about. The problem is that if all we do as believers, if our whole focus is on the social media, what is feeding us? What spiritual truths are we receiving so we can grow? If all we do is spend our time with the news and the media and the books and the news, there's nothing wrong in it. But it becomes wrong when that becomes our focus as believers. Like, I'm very concerned what's happening in the world. But as a believer, I'm not going to be just focusing entirely on media. How am I going to grow as a believer? If all the information I get comes from this secular arena, my God says, the Bible says, you can't seek the counsel of the ungodly. You can't receive all this information from people who don't even know God. I talk to some Christians and I discuss some things and they say, I'm going to go see a counselor. Okay, great. Counselor, who is it? And they start giving me names of people who don't even know that God exists. And you want to seek counsel from an atheist or from a non-believer? How can this be? That doesn't mean that person's not wise or has some kind of ability. I'm not saying that person does. What I'm trying to say, my friend, what fellowship does darkness have with light? I'm not saying that person's not a nice person. I'm not saying that person doesn't have something to offer. What I'm saying is, if you don't know God's word, you won't have the discernment to know the difference between right or wrong. That's what I'm saying. The word transformation is extremely important because it's also not only written in the passive tense where we allow God, it's also in the present participle. It means on to keep on being transformed. So if we think we just pick up the Bible once every 2 weeks or come to church on a Sunday morning and hear pastor's sermon, that's good. I'm very happy you do that. It's going to take a lot more than that. We have to have the word of God go deep into our hearts, you see. So it starts in the mind and it drops down into our hearts. And that's when you know things are beginning to change. The problem is, a lot of times it stops right here. And all it becomes is knowledge. And we learned last week that knowledge puffeth up. The most pompous believers are those who just have knowledge. The Pharisees that Jesus dealt with, all they had was knowledge. They didn't have any heart because the knowledge they had was just here. It was the letter of the Logos, the letter of the Word. It didn't drop into their spirit, or it became the spirit of the Word. We need to be transformed daily. It's a daily transition. It's a process. It's a process, and it takes discipline. The most godliest people I know take discipline. It's about discipline. It's not just, whenever I feel like it. Listen, your feelings can be your worst enemy when it comes to spiritual truth. Feelings will destroy you. Feelings will control you. Feelings will tell you, oh, I don't feel like praising. I don't feel like going to church. It's too cold outside. And everyone said, feelings will control your life. We live in a very feeling environment. I have a name. I think I've said this before. I call it hot tub Christianity. Get the goosebumpies, and I don't feel. Look. I'm a very feely kind of person. I got a lot of feelings. Believe me, I got a lot of emotions. But I've learned if I'm going to be a true man of God, my emotions have to be in check. I can't let my emotions control my life. My emotions are not my good friends. They might like me, but they hurt me. We get offended with our emotions. We get upset with our emotions. We get angry with our emotions. We get lazy with our... It's our emotions will take you away from God, not closer to God. Amen. Doesn't mean God hasn't given us emotions. We have. You see, with emotions, we can also have passion for God. So you see, it all depends how we look at it. But the bottom line is, it needs and takes discipline to be a man or a woman of the word. You must be focused. We allow God's Spirit to touch us, but we must seek the Lord and study His word so that our minds are being transformed, that goes into our hearts, and we notice that in that process, my life begins to change. That's why there are people that can come to church for 30 years and they're still the same. They're not transformed because it's just stayed here. It hasn't gone down here yet. Paul tells us to exercise ourselves unto godliness. We talked about this last week. Exercise is a Greek word, gymnastiki, which is the English words gymnastic or calisthenics. Paul tells us in 1 Timothy 4:7 to exercise, to do your exercises spiritually. And part of our exercises is prayer and the study of God's word. Part of our exercise is going to take place at the end of this month. We've dedicated ourselves to 3 days of prayer and fasting. Yes, fasting is also part of that. To fast, to deny yourself, to deny your flesh, to seek the Lord, to ask the Lord to come into your heart, to pull away things that might dissuade you. Let me tell you something. Sometimes food, as good as it is, we can't survive without it. Sometimes food can just, you know, having a great big meal all the time and eating all the time, you know, that can be just as part of the flesh as gossip can, or lying or cheating. It's called gluttony. I never knew a godly man who had a gluttonous meal before he preached. Doesn't work. What I'm trying to say is that fasting gets us to a place where we become more sensitive to God's word rather than my needs, you see. And so we're going to be doing some of that this end of this week. We're going to be praying and fasting and seeking the Lord, because it's biblical, because Jesus tells us when you fast, not if. So we're going to fast, we're going to seek the Lord, and we're going to cry out for God to give us, I like this, discernment, for God to give us an understanding of His word, for God to pour out His spirit in our midst. It takes discipline, my friend. But unfortunately for some, it's just on the exterior, it's just on the surface. I was telling my neighbor Jason, I'm so glad he's with us today. I was telling Jason on the way to church, I said, you know, Jesus didn't come to change my shirt, you know. He didn't come to change my earrings or my socks. Because some of us think that being holy is only how we look. Oh, yeah, that man there, he look at him, he can't be holy. Just look at his hair. And we look at holiness by the exterior. Now, there's some truth. You know, you're not going to look like some kind of a, you know. But my point is, Jesus didn't come to change my shirt. He didn't come to change what's on the exterior. That's a nice shirt, by the way. But He didn't come to change your shirt. He came to change my heart. You see? He came to change what's inside, what He really cares about. He came to change the real you and the real me. He came to change my life. He came to make me live. That's what a metamorphosis is, a transformation. To change my heart. But it all starts in your head, in your mind. That's why Joel said, don't render to God your garments. Don't render to God what's on the exterior. Some of us render our exterior to God. That doesn't make a difference. It's not going to go deep. It won't really change you. Some of us just render our lips. Isaiah said, don't serve God with your lips. Just what you say. It's got to be a lot deeper, deeper. It's not about the exterior, you see. He didn't come to change my exterior. It's not what He came to do. There are a lot of us that might sing the songs and we might talk the talk and we sound very Christian. And some of us have adopted a new language. It's called Christianese. Have you ever heard Christianese? I've heard it. I hear it all the time. It's Christianese. It's very Christian-like conversation. But that's all it is. We talk it, but do we really live it? Is it real? Is the God of the Bible, is he real in your life? The God in whom we worship, do we really know him? Do we know the author of the Bible? You see, that's what we want to enter into. That's where we get into some transformation. That's where we start to understand who he really is. We begin to see him for who he is. And that's why Jesus said to the Pharisees, he said, you look like white sepulchers. You're so nice and you're clean on the outside, white sepulchers. You look so beautiful. But inside those sepulchers, which is like a coffin, you're just full of dead men's bones. You're not alive at all. You're dead. You look good, you're white-like. In other words, clean, you look clean, but you're dirty. Wow. That's very piercing to me. Paul said the very same thing for some people. He said, you have an appearance of being godly, an appearance, but you deny his power, his dynama, the Greek word, power. You have no power in your life. Let me ask you a question, folks. Please, do you have power in your life? What do I mean by power? I've got power. No, do you have power? What I mean is, do you have something inside of you that sets you apart? When people see your life, do they see something different in your life? Is there a power? Is there an anointing in your life? Is there the Spirit of God? Is the Spirit of God moving in your life? Is there something happening in you that people can see that you're not like everyone else? You've got this power, this anointing, having an appearance of being godly, but deny the power. You see, these people don't have any power to live right because they're not living right. You see, it's God's power that helps you to live the way he wants you to live. You can't do it on your own. You can't. I need God's power in my life. I need God's blessing. And God tells me, I can give you this power. God tells me, I can bless you. I can bless you if you just open your heart and your mind and you renew your mind and you begin to focus in on my word. I got another text, George. It's found in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 3. And this is going to set us very, very clear into what I'm trying to say. Ephesians chapter 2, one of the greatest books in the Bible. And you hath he quickened. Notice the word quickened. That means he's empowered you by his Spirit. Very important. Watch this. And you, O Ephesians, or you, O Christians, he hath quickened. He's empowered you by the Spirit. You were dead in your sins. Verse 2. When in times past you walked according to the course of this world. So when you were dead, when you're dead, you're walking like everybody else. You're on the same wavelength. The world's on an FM band, but the Christian's on the AM band, if you will. You walked a certain way. You talked, you walked, you flowed like everybody else. You're just part of the world according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of now we're getting a little deeper. What do you mean now Paul is talking about a spiritual, he's talking about a demonic realm. He's talking about a spiritual realm. The spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. So now Paul says, listen, you used to walk a certain way, a ways of the flesh, the ways of the world. And you were being governed by the devil, by the god of this world. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4 says, in whom the god of this world has influenced or blinded. That speaks of the devil. In other words, Paul's saying, you walked a certain way like everybody else did, being controlled by the devil. You didn't know it, but because the devil is the author of the things of this world. The devil is the author of all that is corrupt. And so you have followed that prince of that power. You have followed the way of this natural realm, and you've continued that way, but God has quickened you. God has turned you around. So don't go back to that old lifestyle. Don't go back to that old lifestyle to find your advice, to get your direction. You can't do that. In times past, You walked a certain way, but now that you've been quickened, you don't have to revert back to your old ways. How many people have given their lives to Christ and they're shouting hallelujah? And we sing the song, I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back. And Monday morning, we're turning back. Paul says, don't do that. Why would you want to do that? Why would you do that? If you're born again, you're taking the advice of the ungodly. It's going to affect you very badly. You've been transformed. There's a new thing going on. Something has changed. You've been quickened by His Spirit. So we don't need to turn back to the world or be governed by the enemy and the god of this world anymore. We don't need to do that. We have His Word. We just focus on God's Word. You know, sometimes a problem arises, we get all crazy, we pick up the phone, oh, and we start calling Aunt May, Aunt B, Susan, Paul, Pastor. We call everybody we can think of. Instead of thinking of, maybe I should get alone with God. Maybe I should pick up the Bible. Listen, we all got problems. Guess what? I got some problems too. You got problems, Pastor? Oh, come to my house and I'll show you some problems. We got problems. All of us has got problems. Don't think because you're a believer, you don't have problems. You might have more problems. You see, the seeking of the Lord and His Word is not a subjective thing. It's not some people need. That's what I hear. Well, you know, Pastor Dino, you know, that person really needs to get to know the Word of God. Oh, yeah, what about you? Well, yeah, I'm okay. You know, I go to church. Listen, we all need to do this. I've been studying the Bible intimately for 30 years. I still don't even know it. There are things I learn every day on my face as I'm crying out to the Lord. The Lord speaks to me about something as I'm going to share with you today as I close. Something fresh off the press. You see, the Bible is not a regular book. It's not a newspaper you pick up at the local market. It is the inspired Word of God. Listen, when you read God's Word, it's as if He's speaking to you face to face. Man, it's only 12:30, Brother Josh. I'm doing good. You know, I'm almost finished. Can you imagine that? I said almost finished. Did you notice? I said, but we're getting there. And so, the Bible tells us in Ephesians that it was the spirit of the world that operated in the children of disobedience. When you disobey, when you're living in disobedience, when you're living by the fashions of the world, you're being governed by the spirit of the world. George, can you please give me 2 Corinthians 4:4? Who is the spirit of this world? It speaks of the devil. You're governed by the ways of the enemy, and we don't even realize it, some of us. In whom the god of this world, who's that? Notice it's a small g. It's not God the Father. It's God, Satan, the devil. The god of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not. You see, the devil wants to blind you. The devil wants to deceive you. The devil wants to dissuade you. The devil wants to give you all kinds of things to focus in on except God's Word. He'll tell you to do everything else, but don't see God. Which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is in the image of God, should shine. Did you see that? Paul says, you used to walk that way, but you're not doing that anymore. This spirit of the world is very strong. It's very persuasive. This spirit of the world, the ways of this world is very, very strong. And if you won't have the Word in you, you'll have no discernment to know the difference. I've met some Christians, please understand what I'm going to say. And I say this with reverence and brokenness. I'm counseling some people. It's not now. Let me just say for the record, it was not here in this church. So I just want you to know. No, it's the truth. I had a Christian couple that said, well, you know, Pastor Dino, you know, my girlfriend wants to get the pill. I said, the what? The pill. Oh. I said, why would you want the pill? Are you married? No. I said, hold on. How long have you been a Christian? Oh, 10 years. Oh, really? Wonderful. And what are you telling me? Well, you know, we're living together and we're having sex together and I want to... back up a minute. Just back up, please. And I want to know if getting the pill would be... What is your advice, Pastor Dino, for the pill? I said, excuse me, let's hold on a second. You've been Christian for 10 years. You're telling me we're fornicating on a regular basis. We're living there. And now you're telling me I want a pill so we can not get pregnant. So I said, you know what? Why don't you go see philosopher counselor Edward Smith down the street, please? You're in the wrong place. You can't be blessed by God by living the ways of the world. Can't. We don't have discernment. Bible says to prove. You can't prove what is God's will if you're being governed by the fashions and the rudiments of this world. The spirit of the world is very strong. It's deceptive. It will make you think things are good when they're not. It'll make you think things that don't make sense. But you see, you're being blinded. We're being blinded by the enemy who's very strong to confuse and to deceive and to influence. And so we need to resist. To resist this advice, to separate ourselves. Otherwise, see, we have no strength in ourselves to resist. We need God's grace, but we have it. He said he has quickened you. And that's why Paul was upset with the Galatians in Galatians 3. He said, who has bewitched you, O Galatians? You started so well in the spirit. Why are you going back into the flesh? He says, who hath bewitched you? That's a demonic term. Who has put a curse on you, so to speak? That's what Paul's saying. You started in the spirit, and now you're walking in the flesh again, back to the old ways of the world. Who has cursed you to believe this? Listen, this is not my words. These are Paul's words. This is the word of God speaking. This is not, so, you know, sometimes people say to me, Pastor Dino, I didn't like what you said. Well, okay, I love you, brother, but I didn't say it. What do you mean? You said, yeah, I said it, but Jesus said it. Paul said it. I'm just a messenger, folks. That's all I am. I'm not original at all. I'm just speaking what the Bible says because I believe the Bible. Because the Bible and His Word has set me free. Because Jesus has set me free. I believe what He says, and I've persuaded that He is able to do all, above all that I ask, or can even imagine, through the power, same word as quicken, that works in me. I can live above the standards of this world. I can live above the rudiments of this world. I can separate myself because He's touched me. His grace has touched me. I have the ability to resist. Notice, please, verse 4, George, of Ephesians chapter 2. Look at this very, very interesting word. Verse 4 of Ephesians 2. Watch this. Verse number 4, George. But God, who is what? Rich in what? It's His mercy that He's pulled me out of this miry clay. I waited patiently for the Lord, and He inclined unto me, and He heard my cry, and He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and He set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. He is rich in mercy. The word rich is plutokratos, Greek word, which means really wealthy. We serve a very rich in spirit God. In other words, His power is not based on limitations. He is limitless. He can do whatever He can do. Listen, there's nothing God cannot do to sustain you. He never runs out of His power. He never runs out of mercy. He never runs out of grace. His grace is always sufficient for me. His mercy is always sufficient for me. What is mercy? Giving us things that we don't deserve. We don't deserve His mercy, but He gave it to us anyway. And by His mercy, He has quickened us. He has blessed us. so we can resist. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. For greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world. I don't need to go back to the ways of the world. Greater is he that's in me. By his grace and by his power and by his mercy and by his quickening strength, I can overcome sin. I can become an overcomer because he lives in me. His power resides in me. And so the point is, all of this starts in my mind. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That's what needs to change. My thinking. How do you think? Proverbs tells us, as a man thinketh, so is. As a man thinketh, if you think about certain things all the time, that's what you're going to be like. Well, Pastor Dion, I got a problem with certain things. You know, I said, well, why are you watching those programs? Why are you reading that material? As a man thinketh, so is he. As a man thinketh, I got to change my thinking. And some of my thinking might be stinking. just stinking thinking. But it's true. We got to change it. Can't change it in my own strength. God's got to help me. He's got to. So I'm going to allow his spirit to touch my heart. And as I allow it by willing, then in my willingness, God's going to quicken me and strengthen me so I can follow what he wants me to follow. Do you remember the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15? The Bible says he just wanted to leave. Left his father and his inheritance, took all the money he can get, and he want to enjoy life. He partied, he had all the fun he can have, and that's what the world wants. It wants to eat, drink, and be merry. They want to have fun, they want to dance, they want to party, and I know that, I understand that. It's just the way of the world. But you know, one day he got fed up. One day the Bible says he ended up in a hog pen, in a pig pen. He lost everything. You know, when you want to live that kind of lifestyle, if you're not careful, you're going to lose everything. You're going to lose everything. And then your friends, they won't care about you. They don't care about you anyway. They just want the things you got. When you make a lot of money and you're very famous. When I was in Los Angeles and I had a chance to make this television program, I was offered lots of money and fame. You should have seen the friends that wanted to befriend me. Oh, man. Oh, Dino, do you remember me? I spoke to you last year. Oh, yeah, wonderful. Can we? Wonderful. Why are you so interested all of a sudden? People will always be interested if they can get something from your life. Well, he lost everything, the Bible says, and he had no more friends. And he's in the pig pen, and the Bible says something powerful. And one day he came to his senses. Something happened in his head. He realized, wait a minute, I made a huge mistake, man. What did I do? And the Bible says, and he said to himself, I will arise and go back to my father's house. Something, the lights came on. See, it's your thinking. How you're thinking in your head. You can't take advice from the ungodly because they're going to help you think the way they think. And you're going to follow the way they think. Can't do that. You see, you will go where your mind takes you. You will go where, as you're thinking, as you're musing things over, you will go to that place as you meditate on whatever you're thinking about. Your legs will take you there. Your disposition will take you there. Your thinking is so important. If you think you're going down, you're going down. It's a mindset. So if you want to be transformed, then you got to change your thinking. Got to change how I think. Notice verse number 3, George, of Ephesians. Notice chapter 3, please, of Ephesians chapter 2. Watch what it says here. A bit of a Bible study this morning of Ephesians. It says, we too are previously lived among them in the fleshly desires, carrying out the inclinations of our flesh and thoughts. And by nature, look at this, by nature we were children under the wrath, as the others were, by nature. You see, we are all born with a sinful nature. That's why when I ask people, are you a Christian? How long have you been a Christian? Oh, well, Pastor, I was born a Christian. You're not born a Christian. You must become a Christian. You were born like everybody else with a sinful nature. Did you see that? Whom also we all had our conversation or lifestyle in times past in the lust of, we were all of us are born in this way. We all grow up with this tendency and propensity, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and we're by nature children. You see, we are all naturally inclined the same way. We're all sinful creatures. All of us are born. We all have sin. And you see, when Jesus came and died for us through his blood and his death and resurrection, he can transform us from this natural mindset. If any man be in Christ, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. If, it's a choice. If any man be in Christ, he is a what? A new creation. You're changed. All things have passed away. Behold, all things become transformation, a metamorphosis. Morphosis has happened. That didn't happen when you were born. It happened when you received Christ. And so our nature changes. God changes us. George, verse 4, please, of Ephesians. Watch this now. This is so beautiful. But God, that's all you have to, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love, he's changed us, he touched us. My friends, you might be in debt this morning, you might be in a crisis, you might be discouraged, you might be going through all kinds of temptation, you might be discouragedly down and you're depressed and you seem like there's, it almost seems like there's no hope. Let me tell you this morning, God is rich in mercy. God is able to sustain you. Ephesians tells us that God is able to do all that we ask or can imagine or even comprehend according what? To the power. He's got power that lives in us. That's what rich in mercy means. God's Spirit lives in us. When you receive Christ, his Spirit comes to dwell within you, the Bible says. And so, number one, I am not going to walk in the counsel of the ungodly. My first don't. My second and third don't are very quickly, as we can about to, very second. Second don't. Don't stand in the way of sinners. Wow. Don't stand in the way. What does that mean? Don't be a coward. How many Christians, they're just cowards. Yeah, you might be in an office, you might be in a party of sorts or some kind of fellowship at work or whatever you might be, at school. Oh yeah, especially school. And there's all kinds of people and maybe they're making fun of Christianity. And you, oh boy, I don't want to be ashamed. I don't want to have people make fun of me, so I'm just going to stand around. I'm going to hang around these people because I don't want them to make fun of me. No conviction. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It's the power of God. I'm not ashamed of what God has done for me. I'm not a coward. I'm going to run away. I'm going to stand for what I believe in. I'm going to stand for righteousness. I'm going to stand for truth. I'm not going to stand in the way of sinners because I might be a little scared or ashamed. I'm not going to do that. Not being able to stand speaks of a lack of conviction. See, the problem today is not necessarily sin. The problem today is a lack of conviction. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm really not. Because God saved me. God changed my life. He gave me peace and joy. How can I be ashamed of the one who died for me? Amen. I can't. I must stand. Do you remember Moses? When the people of Israel were rebelling against God, he drew a line. He says, all right, man, who's going to stand for God? Come over here. And who doesn't stand for God? I want you to go over there. I tell you, my friends, there's a plumb line drawn even today. Who's going to stand for God? Can't play games with God. That's why Elijah said, how long have you been between two opinions? How long? Either you serve God or you serve Baal. Take a stand, Christian friend. Stop compromising. Stand for what is right. Stand for what... You see, when you stand for God, you are identifying yourself with Jesus. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Jonathan Edwards, one of the greatest preachers of all time. Great revivalist, 18th century. I read some of his stories. Oh, he said this, "Sirs," I quote him, "I have made two resolutions in life. Number one, I will live for God. Resolution number two," he said, "I will live for God even if no one else does." He took a stand. John F. Kennedy, the president of the United States, said in the 60s, "If you don't stand for something, you're going to fall for anything." I'm not going to fall for anything because I'm standing with Jesus. Number three, my third don't. Don't sit in what? The seat of the scornful. Oh my goodness. Don't hang around people who are full of scorn and bitterness. Don't sit. Sit means to have fellowship with. Don't associate with the scornful. You can't hang around people who are bitter and not be changed. Bitter people always see the negative. They don't see any situation as positive, and it becomes contagious. It might be good. It might be some great things happening, but a scornful person will say, "Oh, but you didn't notice this thing." A scornful person will always find a hair in the pie, even if there's no hairs. You ever see them? There's a hair here. There's no hair, but you're finding a hair. A scornful person always sees the glass half empty because you're bitter. Everything is dark. Everything is negative. You're not objective. You're not flexible. You've been hurt. I understand that. We've all been hurt, but you've allowed your hurt to fester, and it's caused us to become bitter, become cynical. You can't be blessed if you're sitting with the scornful, because what's going to happen to you is you're going to be contaminated with the scornful, and it's going to become your lifestyle. If you don't believe me, just watch it. You hang around people like that, you are going to receive it. I know people in the church, they might be praying and worshiping God. I know some people, but somehow there's a bitterness, there's a negativity about them, because it's what happened in their past, and it seems to somehow entered into their hearts. And as positive as they can be, you always somehow sense an aroma of negativity because they've been hurt and they haven't really dealt with it. Bitterness is like a cancer. It will take away anything that is good. It will make you think that everything is black and dark and ugly, even when the light is shining right in your face. You see, you can't be a scornful person if you're in God's word. I'll tell you why. Because God's word is a word of hope. You see, when you begin to study this word and absorb it into your heart, life begins to spring. That's why David said, "My expectation comes from God. In his word do I hope continually," David. You can't be a bitter person when you know the word of God. "So I can't hang around the scornful," David says. It's going to affect you. Let it go. Let it go. Everything is tainted. Everything is cynical. Let it go. Let it go. Let it go. Be careful. Don't be influenced. Let it go. Don't be a person that holds on to it. Let it go. Otherwise, it's going to destroy you. Let it go. And sometimes you wonder why God isn't blessing you. Maybe you've become so cynical over the years that God can't bless you even if you wanted to. Let it go. Let it go. Let it go. Number one. If you want to be blessed, don't walk the counsel of the ungodly. Number two, don't stand in the way of sinners. Number three, don't sit in the seat of the scornful. And we come finally to our first don't, our first do, rather. Three don'ts, here's our first do. Just one do. One do, here it is. But whoa, what a do this is. And when I talk about a do, I'm not talking about a hairstyle. My hair is kind of fading. But I'm not talking about a do. I'm talking about the do according to God's word. Here's the do. What a do it is. Verse 2, George. Blessed is the man that his delight... Oh my God, here it is. is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he what? And what's going to happen as he meditates day and night on God's word? Look, whatsoever, look, and he shall be like what? The tree that's planted by the waters, the rivers, that bringeth forth fruit in season, and his leaf, a leaf. What do you mean? A leaf also shall not wither. Your leaf, all that ugliness. Yeah. Whatever you do is going to prosper. Wow. His delight is in the law. You want to be blessed? Your delight is in the law. I got to start. Lord, I want to love you. Lord, my delight is in your. If I delight in your, watch this. If I delight in your word, then I'm going to start studying it. If I delight your word, I'm not going to carry it like a good luck charm. I know some people, well, I got the Bible beside my bed. Wonderful. That's wonderful. You got the Bible beside your bed. Wonderful. I also got it on my coffee table. Ooh. Well, you're doubly blessed. Wonderful. Listen, the Bible is not a good luck charm. It's not a good luck charm. You can have 1,000 Bibles in your room. What good is it if you don't know the God of the Bible? In his law do I meditate. Now, you've been with me a while, last year, 1 year. Some of you have just started coming. You've heard me talk about meditating. What does the word meditate mean in the Hebrew? Remember? To regurgitate, to chew. The idea, you ever see a cow chew, by the way? When I was living in PEI, I was pastoring there for 3 months. I was on an internship. I lived beside a farm, a lot of farms in PEI. And there were some cows. And I'd wake up early in the morning and I see the cows and they're chewing. And this one cow especially, because it's right near my window. He'd be chewing. At lunchtime, I'd get up, you know, after I wasn't getting up. I got to have some lunch after, see, whatever. I did some things in the morning. And I see the same cow, he's chewing. He's still chewing. You see, meditation means to chew the cud as a cow would chew. It keeps chewing and chewing and chewing till you get all the ingredients out of that hay or grass that the cow is eating. I can figure out how a brown or black cow eats green grass and produces white milk. I still can't figure it out. But you see, if you're chewing on God's word and you're meditating on God's word, something's going to happen to you. You notice day and night, it's not just some passing fad. You know, how many people just come, they praise the Lord, oh, it's exciting, and then you never see them again. I've been in this church a year. There are some people I haven't seen in months. I call them up, how you doing? Oh, well, all kinds of, listen, I'm not demeaning you I'm just saying, you see, when you begin to meditate on God's word, it's not just something that comes, there's something you're hungry, there's a passion, you delight in his law, something has happened in your heart that gives you the desire to read his word. When I first got saved and I understood the power of God in my life, when I realized what God did in my life, I was living in Hollywood. And I just sat on my porch, and I'd be reading the Bible hours a day. And my friends, well, what are you doing? Why don't you just go to your interview? Or aren't you waiting by the phone in case you get another call from an agent or something? I said, I don't care. I just want to read God's word. My delight is in the law of the Lord. And as I started reading God's word, my life started changing. They have to tell me that doing things, certain things are wrong. I knew it because God was speaking to me. God was giving me discernment, proving what is the will of God, Romans. See, as you begin to meditate on God, he begins to give you insight and understanding to life and to principles of life. You live a certain way, day and night. And so God will bless you. His delight is in his law. And he meditates day and night. He's being transformed. He loves his word. You're studying. And the result is, what's the result? He shall be like a tree that's planted by the river that brings forth fruit. You'll be a fruitful person. You'll bear fruit. It speaks of stability. It speaks of his timing. You'll be a fruit bearer. How many people are maybe Christian for years, but they're not really bearing fruit? There's just no evidence. Very little evidence, very little fruit. But Jesus said, hereby is my Father glorified. John chapter 15, I believe it's the 8th verse. Here is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit. You'll be a fruit bearer as you're meditating on God's word. Notice, in due season, I love that. Bringeth forth his fruit in season. In season or due season. What does that mean? That means it's about Dutch timing. It means that as you continue to read and meditate, there's going to be a time that it might be dry in your life, but that season will come where fruit will come. Fruit is not born overnight. There's a season for it. You keep diligently seeking God, pursuing after the Lord, and in due season, at that right moment, God's going to cause fruit to rise up in your life. The blessing will come as you persevere and seek him. I love what it says in Psalm 145. The eyes of all who wait upon God, thou givest them their meat in due season. It's coming, friends. Do not be weary in well-doing, Galatians chapter 6, for in due season you shall reap a harvest. You keep seeking God. You keep diligent. You keep reading and praying. God's going to do something special. There's a time of preparation. There's a due season. You know why? Notice what it says here. Because winter's coming. Look, look, look. Don't rush the season. Don't complain about the coldness, about the winter. Winter is here. The sap will flow again. You see, notice it says, your leaf. There's no fruit when there's leaves. That means that even as you're pursuing God, there might be a dry time where there's no fruit. Look what it says. His leaf also shall what? It won't wither. What do you mean it won't wither? And whatever he doeth, you mean even my leaf will prosper? Even when I'm going through a hard time and it seems like nothing's happening. Yes, even in that dry time, God is going to bless you. Even that time where you don't see much fruit, God is going to bless you. God will prosper you. God will give you influence. God will make a way for you. Because you have delighted in his law. And in his law did he meditate day and night. We're going to study his word this year. We're going to study it. We're going to study about God, his attributes. We're going to learn who he is. I pray that God will cause us to trust him so we can know him. To know him is to trust him. To trust him is to know him. You see, it wasn't your season. Some of you might be in a leaf moment right now. And you're discouraged. It's not your season right now. Not your season to be fruitful right now. Because God's preparing you for the right time. It's all about his timing. But your season is coming, my friend. Your season is around the corner. My hope is in God. Though tears may endure for a night, joy cometh in the morning. I'm going to wait and trust God. I'm not going to go back to the ways of the world. I'm not going to seek counsel from the ungodly because I see a leaf in my life. I'm going to trust God to persevere. Because I know in due season, something's about to happen. Something good is about to happen. I had a friend of mine, I won't mention his name. When I first started ministry in 1984, I graduated from Bible college. In 84, I started ministry right away. There was a man I met in the first church I pastored, one of the most godliest men I've ever met. What a gift. What an anointing. One of the greatest preachers. I aspire to maybe even preach half the way he preaches. What a man of God. Never had a place to preach. Nobody acknowledged him. Couldn't believe it. He said, Pastor, whatever you need me to do, I'll do. This is the greatest preacher I have ever heard, even at that time. And he would help the pastor. He would vacuum the church, clean the toilets at times, run on errands. He told me God would give him sermons. He had no place to preach them. The pastor never asked him to preach. I said, what? Wow. The reason why I knew he preached well is because I had him preach when I went to places to preach. I'd have him come with me. I was shocked. All these things. But he just persevered. Never complained. He just cried out to the Lord. You see, my friends, it wasn't his season yet. Ah, but God. And one day the season came. One day the leaf turned into a nice apple. And I'll tell you something. He's one of the greatest preachers. Today he travels all over the world. And I preached for him 2 years ago in Montreal. He never gave up. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit, and in his season his leaf also shall not wither. You're not going to wither. But whatever you do, you will be a Joseph. Whatever Joseph did, God blessed him. You know why? Because he trusted in God. You know why? When he's in the pit, he trusted God. When he was in the prison, he trusted God. When he was in the palace, he still trusted God. Many of us, when we get to the palace, we forget God. Joseph never forgot God. He put his word first in his life. Let me close with this. I got to close with this. I was praying this morning. I had an illustration I wanted to close with. And I felt the Lord said, no, I want you to share this with my people. I'm going to do it. Blessed is the man that what? Walketh not? That what? Not standeth in the seat. And what? Not sitteth in the seat of the? But? Law of the Lord, and in his law? His law does he meditate. So he knows his word. God's word, correct? Is that true? We just read that? Come with me about 3,000 years ago, the time of David. David was a man of God, loved the Lord, wrote this psalm, by the way. He wrote many a psalm. He's my favorite character. We're going to do a major study in the life of David, verse by verse. Get ready soon. But something happened one day to David. He was so excited, the Ark of the Covenant came back to Israel. The Philistines had them, had the ark, placed it beside the god of Dagon. You see this in Samuel. And God was upset with that. The god of Dagon's head was chopped, his arms were chopped. The Philistines received boils. They said, I got to get rid of this ark. This doesn't belong to us. We're going to send it back to David. Send the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant represented God's presence. This wasn't something to fool with. And so they sent back the Ark of the Covenant on what? On a cart. Is that true? Got any scholars here with us today? And so they sent back, and David was so excited. We got the ark back. We got the ark back, and they're all excited. They're going to bring it back to Israel. They're going to bring it to Jerusalem. We're all dancing and shouting, and we're all excited. Uzzah the priest is with David. He's all excited. The ark is back. But something horrible happens. As they're taking this ark on the cart, with some oxen, the cart hits a rock and didn't have a 401 here, you know. They didn't have the 410 nicely paved. And when you look at the 401, sometimes you wonder, but you know, just nice. Didn't have that. There were rocks, and the cart hit a rock, and the Ark of the Covenant was about to fall off the cart. God's presence. Oh my. Uzzah, being a priest who knows God's word, right? He's a priest. He's got to know the word of God. He said, oh no. And he went to rescue the ark. And what happened to Uzzah? He died. The Lord smote him, the Bible. What? You know, years ago, I said, Lord, that's terrible. Why would you do that? He wanted to help. He wanted to rescue the ark. That makes sense to me. For years, I'd be upset. Didn't understand. Then I realized something a few years ago. Do you know why a disaster came to Uzzah and to David that day? Because they disobeyed God's word. What do you mean, Pastor? They were all excited. The ark. Oh, no, they disobeyed God's word completely. And the priest should have known better. The priest, who's supposed to teach God's word, should have known. And what? And how are we supposed to transport the ark, the Bible says? The Bible tells us in Exodus and tells us in the Old Testament that when you transport the ark has holes on the side of it. You put staffs through it and you carry it on the shoulders of the priests. You don't put it on the cart. And you might say, Pastor Dino, why, but still, why would God? Then I started thinking, the cart represents the ways of the Philistines. Ah, the ways. The world transported the ark to David on a cart. The world, the enemies of God, the ungodly. And now David and Uzzah are adopting their same principles. So if the Philistines did it this way, then maybe we can do it too. God said to David later, David, you remember what my word says? Oh, yes, Lord. We can't do God's will man's way. And his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law doth he meditate day and night, and his fruit be like a river that's planted by the river. And his leaf shall not wither. And whatever he doeth shall prosper. Can we all stand together, please?